On behalf of IITRAAA Ahmedabad, Shri Achal Khare ji, we welcome you. All the IITRAAA members and audience requested to take their seats, please. Good morning, everybody. Sadar namaskar. जैसा कि आप जानते हैं कि आप यहाँ पर एक बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण व्याख्यान सुनने के लिए आए हुए हैं. आज हमारे बीच उपस्थित हैं एक बहुत ही महान हस्ती. आप लोगों में से कोंकण रेलवे में कितने लोगों ने विजिट किया है? हाथ उठाएंगे. बहुत अच्छा. दिल्ली मेट्रो में? बहुत बढ़िया. अच्छा, कश्मीर कितने लोग गए हैं? ओके, वेरी गुड. कश्मीर में जब आप लोग गए होंगे तो आपने वहाँ देखा होगा कि वहाँ पे रेलवे की बहुत ज़रूरत है. भारत सरकार वहाँ पे बना रही है रेलवे. ये जो चीज़ें मैंने आपको गिनाई, जब हम भारत की प्रगति की बात करते हैं और रेल नेटवर्क की बात करते हैं, तो ये कुछ ऐसे फीडर्स हैं जो कि बहुत ही इम्पोर्टेंट हैं. ऐसा ही एक भारत की प्रगति रेल नेटवर्क में एक नया आयाम जुड़ने वाला है, वो है हमारा मुंबई अहमदाबाद हाई स्पीड रेल. और भारत सरकार ने जिस व्यक्ति के हाथ में ये उत्तरदायित्व दिया है, वह व्यक्ति आज हमारे सामने उपस्थित है, हमारे बीच उपस्थित हैं, वो ये इस लेक्चर को देंगे. लेकिन ये है कि पहले हम प्रोग्राम की तरफ बढ़ें. आज के प्रोग्राम की जस्ट रूपरेखा बता देता हूँ कि हमारा सबसे पहले एक ब्रीफ इंट्रोडक्शन होगा कि हमारा ये जो डॉक्टर एन खोसला लेक्चर सीरीज क्या है उसके बारे में, IITRAAA क्या है, वो क्या करते हैं, बहुत ही ब्रीफ होगा. और फिर उसके बाद पूरा लार्ज स्केल का एक लेक्चर होगा हमारे चीफ गेस्ट और इन्वाइटेड स्पीकर के द्वारा. आप उनसे क्वेश्चन आंसर पूछ सकते हैं. तो सबसे पहले हम क्या करेंगे, सबसे पहले हम अपने मेहमान को ऊपर बुलाएंगे, उनका स्वागत करेंगे. तो मैं रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा सुधीर जैन सर को, वो ऊपर आएं और अपने साथ में चीफ गेस्ट श्री अचल खरे जी को लाएं. हमारा IITRAAA, आइए सर, वेलकम सर. हमारे IITRAAA अहमदाबाद चैप्टर के फाउंडिंग मेंबर और फाउंडिंग प्रेसिडेंट, आज हमारा IITRAAA चैप्टर जहां पर है उसके आधार से आप बोल सकते हैं, श्री AC माथुर. मैं उनको रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा वो भी डाइस पर आए. श्री JC सेठी जी, मैं आपको रिक्वेस्ट करता हूं आप भी. PK तनेजा साहब, तनेजा साहब से आप लोग परिचित होंगे. अगर पिछले बार आए थे तो तनेजा साहब का वरद हस्त हमेशा हमारे ऊपर होता है, हमारे प्रोग्राम को बिल्कुल जब भी मौका जरूरत पड़ती है हमारा सहयोग देते हैं तनेजा साहब. हमारे सेक्रेटरी डॉक्टर सुशील सिंह, आइए प्लीज. अब जैसे कि हमारी भारतीय संस्कृति है, सबसे पहले हम अपने मेहमान का स्वागत करेंगे. हमारे नए सेक्रेटरी यंग एंड एनर्जिक डायनेमिक हिमांशु थुशियार से मैं रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि वो उस फूलों से स्वागत करें हमारे चीफ गेस्ट श्री अचल खरे जी का. डॉक्टर सुशील सिंह से रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि हमारे IITRAAA अहमदाबाद के प्रेसिडेंट डॉक्टर जैन साहब, डॉक्टर सुधीर जैन का स्वागत करेंगे. श्री मनीष सेठ से मैं रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि वो श्री PK तनेजा जी को फूलों से स्वागत करेंगे. डॉक्टर अमित प्रशांत, आपसे रिक्वेस्ट है कि आप स्टेज पे आइए, श्री सेठी जी का स्वागत करेंगे। डॉक्टर हरजिंदर सिंह से रिक्वेस्ट है कि वो आके एसी माथुर साहब का स्वागत करेंगे। डॉक्टर विक्रांत जैन से मैं रिक्वेस्ट करता हूँ वो डाइस पे आएँ और हमारे सेक्रेटरी डॉक्टर सुशील सिंह का फूलों से स्वागत करेंगे। दोस्तों, अच्छा मैं सभी लोगों का धन्यवाद करता हूँ। मैं यहाँ पे आप लोगों के बीच में और स्पीकर के बीच में ज़्यादा खड़ा रहूँ ये अच्छी बात नहीं है, तो प्रोग्राम को आगे बढ़ाते हैं। तो सबसे पहले आप लोगों का फॉर्मल वेलकम करने के लिए और हमारी जो लेक्चर सीरीज़ है डॉक्टर ए एन खोसला, ये क्या है, कैसे स्टार्ट हुआ, इसके बारे में थोड़ा सा इंट्रोडक्शन देने के लिए हमारे प्रेसिडेंट डॉक्टर सुधीर जैन को मैं रिक्वेस्ट करूँगा कि वो स्टेज पर आएँ और इस पर दो शब्द कहें। प्लीज वेलकम डॉक्टर सुधीर जी।
आवर एस्टीम्ड गेस्ट मिस्टर अचल खरे, ऑल द इनवाइटीज, गेस्ट, लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, वेरी हैप्पी टू बी हियर टुडे एंड टू वेलकम मिस्टर अचल खरे, वन ऑफ द वेरी डिस्टिंग्विश्ड रेलवे इंजीनियर दैट आवर कंट्री हैज एंड हु इज कैरिंग ए वेरी वेरी सिग्निफिकेंट रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ऑन विच द होल वर्ल्ड इज लुकिंग एट इंडिया नाउ। The context of this today's lecture is, how many of you are engineering students here? I see a lot of young students. How many of you are engineering students here? Okay, wonderful. So basically, and I have some very eminent railway and other engineers here, and of course Roorkee Alumni Association is full of engineers. One of the challenges today that engineers have is about their space in the society, and that has been a topic of great interest to me. Why the engineers are not as much respected in the society today as they used to be 50 years back. And I have whole theory about it, and I will not go into that theory today. But what I would like to say today is that if there are some icons of engineering excellence that we have in our country, or we have had in our country, Dr. A.N. Khosla would be one of those. Khosla was a Roorkee graduate who went on to work in Punjab Irrigation Department, was the chief engineer for Bhakra Dam, built the Bhakra Dam, and had major role in making Roorkee University what it became later. He became the vice chancellor at Roorkee and one of the most dynamic vice chancellors that Roorkee has had. It was during his time, because he was involved in Bhakra Dam, he knew about the earthquake problem, because Bhakra Dam was built very close to the Kangra earthquake area, and therefore he was very aware of the earthquake problem. In fact, there was a lecture he gave on Indian Geophysical Society in which he talked about India's earthquake problems. So when he became a vice chancellor at Roorkee, he was already well aware of the earthquake problem, happened to go to United States to visit some universities, happened to go to California Institute of Technology, and found that there were two professors who were studying about earthquakes. And he said, my country has a problem of earthquakes and I need that problem to be solved. And that is how he, in fact, pushed Jack Krishna to go to Caltech, learn earthquake engineering, brought those two professors, and it was under Khosla's leadership that Jack Krishna was able to build earthquake engineering at Roorkee, and rest is history today. If India has standing in earthquake engineering, if India today sits on the high table of earthquake engineering, because we started earthquake engineering in 1958, it is a large part due to Dr. Khosla. But then, not just he was a great engineer who built Bhakra Dam and ran a university very successfully that you can really count on his contributions at Roorkee. He was later nominated to Rajya Sabha. He was made the member of the Planning Commission. And finally, he became the governor of Odisha. And that is the kind of profile that engineers had. And for that, They needed to be above board. They needed to do their job very professionally, and they needed to deliver. And in Achal Khare, we have another person. We are hoping, Achal, that in 20 years' time, 30 years' time, people will have Achal Khare lecture on your contributions to the bullet train in India. When, therefore, we at Roorkee Alumni Association in Ahmedabad chapter were looking at what are the things that we should do other than socializing, meeting, holding picnics, and doing get-togethers, we wanted something technical, something which is leveraging the legacy of the great university of which we have been part of. And therefore, we came up with this idea that in honor of one of the most eminent leaders of Roorkee, that is Dr. A.N. Khosla, we will create a lecture. And the first speaker in that series was Mr. Mangu Singh, who is the managing director of the Delhi Metro Rail Corporation. And it is very befitting that Achal Khare is the second speaker today in that series. And we are all eagerly looking forward to his lecture and to learn about the bullet train project, on which we are all very curious, we are all very interested. And we are all holding our breath. We want India to do well on bullet train, because people will watch and will judge India's stature based on success of iconic projects like these. India could do Chandrayaan without much publicity, but India cannot do bullet train without publicity. People will know about it, everybody knows about it, and everybody is talking about it. So this is the background of this lecture. We are delighted to have all of you here today to listen to a very distinguished railway engineer who is leading the country in a very, very interesting area, in a very interesting times. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
थैंक यू वेरी मच डॉक्टर सुधीर जैन. अब आईट्रा के बारे में आपको थोड़ी सी जानकारी, तो मैं श्री एसी माथुर जी से रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि वो आके आपको आईट्रा अहमदाबाद चैप्टर के बारे में थोड़ी सी जानकारी देंगे. काइंडली वेलकम एसी माथुर.
या गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी. Now, there are a lot of people who are not from Roorkee in this hall today. So I would like to tell in brief about the Roorkee, University of Roorkee, and how it became IIT Roorkee. Then in brief about the Ahmedabad chapter of IIT Roorkee Alumni Association, which is one of the very active chapter in the country. In fact, 1845, there was a canal project in Uttar Pradesh, and a training school was started near Saharanpur. And that time there was a proposal was submitted to have a full-fledged engineering college somewhere near Saharanpur. So in 1846, the proposal was submitted for this college. 1847, this college was started at Roorkee. It is was a very small place near Haridwar. And that time, I think it was in Saharanpur district. And 1845, college was renamed as Thompson College of Civil Engineering. It started from civil engineering. Initial days, there was no other branch of engineering in the country. We started from civil engineering. Later on, so many branches have added up. Then 1947, it was renamed as Thompson College of Engineering. They removed civil engineering and made it a College of Engineering. Then 1949, Pandit Nehru, our first PM, he brought a special sanction to this college. They made it as a elevated to University of Roorkee. It was the first technical university in the country. It was first engineering college in the country, and it was the first technical university in the whole of Asia. So we are very proud of that we belong to a college which was the first in the country. And with respect to time, it has progressed well. Then again, 2001, when BJP government came, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, then Prime Minister, he made it brought it University of Roorkee into IIT system and made 7th IIT. So some people think that Roorkee became 7th IIT later on, but it was the first engineering college. It became IIT much later. And when it was Thompson College of Engineering, there was an entrance test. Now we are having entrance test nowadays for admissions in all IITs, colleges, etc. But Roorkee was the first which started long back entrance test for engineering admissions. Then 2018, you see the current year, we have got the largest number of departments in the country. None of the university or college is having. We have got 21 departments, 3 centers of excellence, and 5 service centers. And it has got a very beautiful campus. Some of the figures I will show. This is the main building, which was made by Britishers those days. Those who are from Roorkee, they may be knowing their spouses. Those who are here, they must not have visited Roorkee any time, so just have a glance. And all those who are not from Roorkee and from other engineering colleges, they can have a look. This is the main building. And recently, there are many film producers, they have gone to Roorkee and had shooting. This is our J.J. Thompson building. Another view, they have renamed as J.J. Thompson building. We have got a very beautiful front view. And this building, they have maintained nicely as on today. See, this is the inside view. This was the original building which was made by Britishers, and the college was in this building. Now later on, so many departments have added all around this building. You can see the clock tower, which was established in that time and is still working. They have maintained nicely, and there is a British company who maintains this clock. They call the experts from that place. Now some of the views. You can see the first is that Solani Bridge, where that river flows, Solani River you can see, and over that, that canal is there. Then these are some old views. You can see the mountains with the snow and old bridge. You can see that canal which was made those days. This is bottom side, another view. These lines were established by Britishers those days. And our University of Roorkee, that monogram, it is having this loin photo. Then brief about the Alumni Association. We started sometime in 1983. I am glad to tell you that we are completing 35 years of its establishment in Ahmedabad this year. And successfully, since 35 years we are running very actively this chapter. And we have got around 150 alumni. As on today, in Ahmedabad itself, then we have got some alumni in Surat, Baroda, Bharuch, and Rajkot. It is a registered society as well as trust with Gujarat government. And we have got a office, separate office at Abhijit building, Law Garden. We have got our own website. We have got a Facebook account. We have got our own email ID. Then we have got a 2 saving bank accounts in corporation as well as central bank. Now, you see just where our alumni works. Now, our alumni are in government of Gujarat. Many of them are IAS officers. Taneja ji is one of them who is here, retired as ACS. Then we have got many officers in IPS. They are posted in Gujarat at various places. We have got number of alumni in central government departments who are posted in Gujarat, Airport Authority of India, Railway, ISRO, PRL, Post and Telegraph, TOT, etc. There are many people who are doing their own business in Ahmedabad. They have got some industries. Then we have got in academic institutions like Nirmal University, LD College of Engineering, MSU University, number of alumni are working. Then we have got a Pan IIT Gujarat chapters. Our alumni are active into that also. Then there are many in public sectors. So we have got a good network of alumni in all over the Gujarat. Usually earlier days, you know, this IIT, all graduates who were there from IIT, they used to go abroad. But if you see the Roorkee and most of the alumni, they have served the country in various departments, various states. Even if you go to a small village in the country, you will find a person from Roorkee. They have done a lot of contribution for the development of this country. This I have written members. Now this is our governing council, Dr. Sudhir Jain, one of the very active, dynamic president which we have got, and it is his third term. Then we got Mr. J.C. Sethi, vice president, Dr. Sushil Kumar Singh, our secretary. Then Mr. Himanshu is our joint secretary. Then Manish said is our treasurer, very well maintaining all our accounts. And Ritesh Kumar is our joint treasurer. We have got a membership fee. We charge 2,000 rupees for annual membership from all the members. And then we have got a life membership category where we charge 20,000. They will have to pay only once till they are in Gujarat and need not pay any other amount. So we have got around 38 life members out of 150. Then we do various types of activities in Ahmedabad, philanthropic activities. We have provided financial help to IIT Roorkee students for their project work and for their annual show for which they go abroad. Then we have also provided financial help to Mr. Satyen Dubey's family, who was an IIT Kanpur graduate and who was murdered in Bihar sometime in late 90s. Then we contributed a lot of money and sent to his family. Then we do a lot of social activities, family get-togethers. Then we helped during Gujarat earthquake in 2001, the families who suffered from earthquake. We visited Bhuj and tried to help them. Then we organized cultural activities. Then we have got educational activities. Also, we have got technical excursion. We have visited various dams, Adani ports, power station, oil refinery. And now recently, we have started this invited lecture series, you know, which is gives a is a, tell the general public about the technical things now which we are doing in the country, all important projects. We will try to have more invited talks in the coming times, which gives a good amount of knowledge to our young generation. I think this is a forum where we can transfer what we are learning, what is the new technology, to our younger generation. Thank you very much. This is a last photo, a news bulletin also. It is called Vani, and regularly in three bulletins we are bringing in a year, which contains a lot of information on technical things, social articles, stories, etc. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much, Mathur Sahab. We really thank you for bringing IITRAAA Ahmedabad at this height, and we are proud of you. Now, friends, I'll tell you, now I have to do the most difficult task of this program. I have to do. Mathur Sahab has given this responsibility to me. Why I'm telling most difficult? Because you know very well a person, and it's my duty to introduce you. If you simply type Achal Khare on internet, and you will see hundreds of pages are there. Now, how do I introduce that person? But obviously, it's my duty. Maybe there, maybe you will get some of the points which you may not be aware. So let me introduce in that way. Shri Achal Khare is 1981 Roorkee pass out. He did. He graduated in civil engineering from there. But before going to Roorkee, he did inter college from SMJEC Khurja. It's a near Bulandshahr. And he started his career basically with EIL, Engineers India Limited. And then he became IRSE in 1982, okay? And his first job was in Kapurthala, rail coach factory there. And his responsibility was to maintain and operate the tracks. Then as I was talking about the Kashmir, and there is one very prestigious project that is basically Udhampur Srinagar Baramula rail project. And Khareji has been there for 4 years, 1997 onwards. And 2005, he joined Aircon, now which is called Aircon International Limited. And while in Aircon, he was there in Brazil for 1 year, and he was country head in Malaysia for a project which was a very prestigious $1 billion project. He was then DRM Chakradharpur once he completed his 5 year deputation. So you can say he came back to India in 2010. And before his current appointment as Managing Director in National High Speed Rail Corporation Limited. He was Advisor Infrastructure in Ministry of Railways. So friends, you might have seen that it's not only the technical and managerial experience he's having. In fact, he has dealt a number of matters related to international cooperation. He was basically pioneer in making of a policy framework and its documentation for public-private partnership in railways. When such a great personality is among us, what I'm doing here? I should not stand here. So friends, I request, let me do one thing before that. Before I request Khare sir, I request Jain sir to felicitate our chief guest and speaker, Shri Achal Khare, with a shawl. So I request, can you bring please a shawl here? Jain sir, Ayushman Singh. Jain sir, please. This is working. Working? You check. Okay. So now I request Khare sir. Please welcome Khare sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jain sir, the entire executive body of IIT Roorkee Alumni Association, because probably this is the first time I am getting such a varied gathering of young engineers to old engineers. Some of them, my respected seniors, may be great grandfather in our Roorkee terminology. So it's a very, very diversified gathering of all engineers. Thinking that I'll be talking to all engineers, I've tried to keep in my presentation technical aspect of the project. Probably in this time, I will not be able to explain entire details, but some of the ideas, and then I will leave some food for thought for the young engineers as to how they can come and contribute for the growth of high speed in India and for the growth of the nation as such. So with that, the entire presentation, I think I have about 1 hour. So entire presentation, we have tried to put in 4 parts. General overview, just to make you aware what is Mumbai-Ahmedabad high speed. Then, since all of you are engineers, so I thought it would better to bring out what are the technical challenges, some of the challenges we have found out solution, some of the challenges we are still struggling. Then rolling stock is, if some of you are mechanical engineers, this is one area which is a sea change from what we are practicing as of now. Systems is again a sea change, what we are practicing as of now. Overhead equipment and certain safety, special safety features, which probably first time in the country we are trying for a infrastructure project. And then of course, what I thought could be the seeds for innovations. So I'll leave it here with a request for the faculty and for the students, if we can really work on them in the future. So this is the project all about. If you see, we are on the west coast.
starting from Sabarmati right up to Mumbai. About 2/3 of the project is in Gujarat and 1/3 is in Maharashtra, with a little portion of about 4 km in Dadar Nagar Haveli. We'll have 12 stations starting from Sabarmati, 8 in Gujarat, 4 in Maharashtra. Ahmedabad, Anand, Vadodara, Bharuch, Surat, Bilimora, Vapi, then Boisar, Virar, Thane and Mumbai in Maharashtra. Unique feature, 90% of the project is elevated. It is on viaduct. About 9.22 km is on bridges, long bridges, primarily river bridges. And about 26 km is in tunnel. Out of that, one tunnel itself is around 21 km long. I'll talk about it. And it has 7 km of the portion under the sea. We are crossing Thane Creek. At the approach of the tunnel, civil engineers would understand, at the approach of the tunnel and the viaduct, we have to have some portion on the embankment. So that is the cut and fill portion, about 2.5%. We'll have two type of services. One is limited stop. Limited stop means starting from Sabarmati, it will stop at Ahmedabad, Vadodara, Surat, and then to Mumbai. Total time taken will be 2 hours, 7 minutes. Then we will have another service, which will be all stops, all 12 stations. That will take 2 hours, 58 minutes. The completion cost of the project, as estimated now, is 1,08,000 crore. These are some of the parameters. It will be standard gauge. As of now, Indian Railways is having broad gauge. We had 3 gauges, broad gauge, meter gauge, and narrow gauge. This is the 4th gauge we are bringing, which is standard gauge. So all high speeds will be standard gauge. Reason is the technology world over is available in a standard gauge. Broad gauge, the technology is not available, and we would have to invent a lot of things if we were to go for the broad gauge. The design speed is 350 km per hour. Operating speed will be 320 km per hour. Stations I have explained, wild alignment, everything I think. The longest bridge is on the river Vaitarna, about 2 km, and longest tunnel is 21 km with 7 km portion under the sea. Next. Some of the further statistics, we'll have a train configuration in 2023 when we start, will be 10 coach train. Then 10 years later, when the traffic picks up, we will have 10 as well as 16 coach trains. So we are building the platforms with the 16 coach length train. And in 43, we'll all have 16 coach. 53 is also 16 coach. Right now, 24 rakes we are procuring to meet, to start our operations. Then finally, we will go right up to 71 trains. As of now, we will have 35 trips each way to start with. Then in 2053, it will go up to 105. Train capacity, 10 coaches, 750 seats in one train. 16 coach capacity will have 1,250 seats per train. This is the expected ridership when we start the operation. About 18,000 to begin with each way, and expected to go up to 93,000 in 2053 each way. This is the plan. In peak hours, we will start with 3 trains per hour, so which means every 20 minutes you will have one train service. Off-peak hour, we will have 2 trains. So again, half an hour, you will have trains. Our operations will be from 6 o'clock in the morning to 12 o'clock in the night. From 12 to 6 will be designated maintenance block for the corridor. This is something for the interest of the electrical and mechanical engineers. So we will have 2 depots, one at Thane, another at Sabarmati. Thane and Sabarmati depot will have both 48-hour maintenance, both of them will have. Regular maintenance will be 30 days. Bogey, which is the most important part, will be at Sabarmati 18 months. And I think state of the art machines are being procured. It is going to be a huge depot at Sabarmati, a thing which is worth watching for the engineers once it is established and we start. Then the general maintenance will be 36 months. A special breakdown both at Thane as well at Sabarmati will be able to attend. Power supply, 12 traction substations and 2 depot substations, in addition 16 distribution substations. The difference is traction substation and distribution substation is traction substation is used mainly to feed the trains, for running of the trains, and distribution substation is mainly to feed stations and other installations, the equipment. The overhead OHE stands for overhead equipment, which is which feeds power to the electric train. It is 2 into 25. Generally in India on Indian Railways it is single 25. 2 into 25 is because the speed is more, so the current requirement is more. It's a heavy compound category, catenary. Signaling is digital ATC. ATC stands for automatic train control. And it says Shinkansen is the name for Japanese bullet train, so it is similar to Shinkansen. We will have an elaborate system of disaster prevention. And we are also building, the construction work is already going on, a high-speed, dedicated high-speed training institute at Vadodara, where all our manpower will be trained before our system is operationalized. Yes. Coming to the technical challenges and solutions, of course, the timeline given to us is very, very tight. So this is one of the technical challenge. My corporation was established in February 16, and I took over in April 2017. Till the time, it was only a stopgap arrangement. We have to complete the project in 6 years. We are almost completing our planning and design phase and entering into the construction phase this financial year. Some of the challenges which I thought I share with you, I'll discuss in subsequent slides. So first challenge was for the surveying people. See, 508 kilometer going by the conventional systems, it would have taken 9 months to 12 months to complete the complete final location survey. When I say final location survey, the complete alignment, the geotechnical investigations and all. Then we started searching because this was one of the challenge given to us. And then we came to know, in India we have not used, this is the first time on a railway project we have used this technique, but this LIDAR technique is not something new internationally. It is being used in other countries very extensively. But here then we took this risk, we said, okay, let's try. And as of now, we could find only one company in India who is doing this, so we engaged them. It's a subsidiary of GMR, the name is Geono. And our another railway PSU rights, we engaged them, so who is helping us extensively to do the final location survey. And with that, we could complete this entire survey work in 3 months' time. And the accuracy is quite good. I'll come to how well we are able to use this data. Of course, to do the aerial LIDAR, we had to set up control points. So that is DGPS points. I'll come to further details on DGPS. And then once the LIDAR data we got, so we have used this data for design of alignment, for finalizing the right-of-way, and also to work out the project affected person. The quality of images is so good, you can know from the images how many houses, how many trees are getting affected in the project. Accuracy which we have achieved is 39 mm for the vertical and horizontal is 93 mm. Next. So it's a schematic view. This helicopter is engaged and all the units are fitted into this. The sensor management unit, the aerial radar scanner, computer system, and IMU is inertial measurement unit. Because helicopter will not be flying constantly at one height, it will have some pitching, some yawing. So the correction has to be applied, whatever pitching and yawing is there. So that correction has to be applied to work out the correct level. So that is why this unit is very, very important. So a flight path was finalized depending upon how much width we want to cover. Whatever, if you want to cover higher width, your height of the fly has to be more. We covered about 300 meter, but finally analyzed 100 meter for our project. So the concept is the lidar scanner, it is all the points are hit on this and then taken back. We have 100 MP camera which keeps on taking the photograph. So these ground photographs are then correlated with the laser points with which you are taking the levels. And for working out the accuracy of NXY, it has a GPS unit and then we established a ground GPS stations. This unit will constantly interact with the ground GPS station to see that the XY coordinates are correctly recorded. Next. This is how the entire planning was done. If you see, you would read HSRMA 46. So these are all control stations which we established before taking up the lidar survey. In any case, in any survey, you have to establish triangulation stations. So these stations were established. Average distance was around 25 to 28 kilometer. So this was done first. Then from there, we established secondary control stations at every 5 to 8 kilometer. And these stations were used to get the XY coordinate when we were doing the lidar survey. Entire lidar survey, 508 kilometer, you have to divide it into flight paths. So basically, if this is the center line, if this is the center line, the helicopter will take flights like this to cover the entire width. So these are the flight paths, 259, 260, 261. It will cover a width, there will be overlap. Then from there, we will pick up the complete data. Next. The entire system, there is a laser data which constantly hits the laser beam on the ground and you pick up the levels. Onboard GPS data, which I explained, which constantly interacts with the ground station GPS data. IMU, I explained to make the corrections in the pitching and yawing thing. And then the camera, which takes photos. These two, GPS solution and then IMU data put into this, we get the flight trajectory correctly. From there, then we get the laser data and this corrected flight trajectory will work out the geo-referenced point cloud, and then from there we will extract the ground key points which will give us the level and you can draw the distal terrain model. And of course this along with the ortho photo which we have taken. So you have XY referenced photograph with which you can work. This is, if you try to see, this is torrent chimney and this photograph is taken from lidar. This is Chiman Bhai Patel ROB, which all of us would know. So that is the kind of quality with which we have got with this.
Next.
Just I explained how the flight path is taken in lidar. And this is the point cloud data, which this is 15 points per square meter is capturing. Color difference is because of the levels, different level. So you remove this and then you get the digital model. Blue is the river. This is Sabarmati River only. So it's just a small picture just to show you that how the data is captured. You convert this in, along with the orthophoto, and then you get the real pictures. So this was
something which I can say, it was a successful attempt and it worked very well, and we have been able to use. Luckily, because our consultants are Japanese, so it has been vetted by the Japanese side. So I can say that this is something which has been very well established on the project. Next challenge is the long tunnel, 7 kilometers of which is under the sea. This is tunneling nowadays is not very something special, because a lot of metro people are doing tunneling. But the only difference is, whereas the dia of the metro tunnel is around 6 to 6.5 meter, our tunnel diameter is 13.2 meter. And there are very few tunnels which are currently going on at this dia. It is single digit number, where internationally that you are boring 10 meter or more dia tunnel. One is going on in Hong Kong, another one is going on in Australia. That is, I know only two as of now. So maybe one or two more. So the challenge is large dia. Another challenge is Thane Creek. Now, since it is under the sea, you can't do conventional boring, which we do the bore log. The geotechnical engineers will understand. Because if you do the bore log at the center line over the sea, then it becomes a perpetual point for the ingress of water in the tunnel. So normal bore log we did, not that we didn't do. We did normal bore log, but 75 meters away from the center line. So you have the characteristic, soil characteristic known, not at the exact location of the tunnel, but away. So the Japanese engineers, they were not very sure that what will be there exactly at the tunnel portion. So again, I think for the first time, I think oil people are using this underwater static refresher technique very commonly, but on infrastructure project, we used it for the first time. We didn't have facility here in India. So we engaged a Japanese company, Kawasaki, who came along with their instrument and did this survey. So I think next slide we have the details. Yes. So this is static refraction survey. The technique is you get the velocity measured inside the strata and then correlate the velocity, sound velocity inside the strata with the type of strata. So that is the technique. And it has two ships. One is the static recording ship. Another is the moving ship, which moves along the investigation line. So we moved it along the center line and also across the center line. Now, most important thing in this is this bay cable. It is fitted with hydrophones at every 10 meter. So this was around 600 meter long cable. And this ship with the air gun and a GPS fitted with this, so that the location is clearly controlled. This was one of the very important tasks and very difficult tasks, that how to run this ship along the line on which you want to do the investigation. But I am happy that once trained, a very layman kind of boat driver, he was trained for 5 days by the Japanese, and then he could operate the ship along the center line with very accurate control. Within plus minus 1 meter, he could do that. And GPS will keep on giving him the location. So there was an onboard computer, and then he would know whether he is moving on the center line or he is going away. So he will make a correction. Now, the concept is that the air gun hits the blast at every 5 meter location, and then these hydrophones pick up the return velocity, return sound, and then the velocity is measured. Next. And once you correlate the velocity, then you will know the exact type of strata, what is the type of strata. Now, this is the result which is actually we have got on our site. If you see the blue color is a very good rock. The velocity is around 4,600 to 5,100. The estimated rock mass rating will be around 67 to 74. Ideally, we should have planned our tunnel in this strata. That is the ideal thing. But we are not able to do that. And then we have decided, okay, relatively weaker strata we have to puncture, but then we will take requisite precautions. The reason is this tunnel is very close to our last station, which is Mumbai terminal. Now, if we lower it down, then the station level also goes down very much and the construction of stations become very difficult. So despite knowing that a good strata lies somewhere here, we are not able to do that because of the constraint. Had we had adequate length available, we would have done this. But now, since adequate length is not available with us to achieve the required gradient, we will go in this strata and take. But the beauty is that we know that, okay, now we are going to enter into poor strata and we can take precautions at the time of tunneling. Next. Third issue is three stations, because we were wanting to give connectivity with the existing Indian Railways. For the people who are coming on existing network, they should have access to high speed. So at Vadodara, Ahmedabad and Sabarmati, we are in the existing Indian Railway territory. And all these platforms will be built above the existing Indian Railways platform. Vadodara, if you see, is going to be the longest bridge. We are crossing the entire yard. I'll show a few pictures. So around 240 meter long span, and both side is multi-story building. We don't have a space to do the free work. So it's one of the biggest challenge, I would say, is there on the project. Ahmedabad, again, we are going to have around 120 meter long span. The challenges are to design long span steel bridge with stringent deflection criteria. With the steel bridges, deflection is one of the issue. Work within busy existing railway stations, because we can't close the existing running services. We have to work with those limitations. And steel fabrication, unfortunately, current facilities which are available in private sector or in government sector, somehow they don't meet the required standard for high speed as set by the Japanese. So this is one of the challenge which we are facing. Next. This is something new I also learned after I took over. So the Japanese suggested us that since Vadodara and Ahmedabad is one of the critical thing, so why don't we try this concept of CMGC? CMGC is construction manager, general contractor. And the concept of this CMGC is, normally we do the designs or we do the planning and then either go on BOQ, which is bill of quantity based tender, or on design and build basis. Here, before we really go even for design and build basis and do our some designs, the concept is that you involve the contractor right at the initial design phase. So he knows his construction constraints. A consultant who is a designer will design the structure, but he would not be very, very clear. He would be clear to some extent, but he would not be very, very clear with the kind of temporary structures or kind of temporary arrangements which are required to be made for construction. Now, especially places like Vadodara and Ahmedabad, where we are working very close to existing running track, this aspect becomes very important. And luckily, since Japanese are helping us, Japanese have mastered this art to work very close to the running system. So they suggested that we go for this concept of CMGC, in which the contractor will be involved right at the design stage, and he will suggest innovative construction technology, and the designs will be modified to suit those construction technology. And then this, he becomes, once the design phase is over, we have two phases, pre-construction phase and construction phase. Once the pre-construction phase is over, and when he feels that to some extent designs are finalized, so without waiting for the entire thing to be finalized, if he feels this is the area where we have done sufficiently good enough designs to invite the tender, then he becomes my contract manager. He invites the tender amongst the different, it will be open tender. What we have decided is this tender will be amongst the Indian companies. So the idea is that The expertise in planning comes from Japan, and then execution is done by the Indian company, so they also learn later on. So it is he who will decide that, okay, Vadodara package, I will break it up into 12 subsections or 10 subsections, and whatever subsection is ready, then he does the tender for us. He does the complete fixation of the agency and all, and he is responsible for delivery of the project. In turn, we enter into an agreement with for risk sharing. I think I have not written all those things here. So we enter into an agreement for risk sharing. So before a subcontract is finalized, he will do the risk assessment that, okay, I am doing this sub package. This is the amount of risk involved. This is the value of the risk. Then we enter into a agreement with him, and then see if the risk, actual risk in terms of money value, if they are less than what he has assessed, it's fine. Then whatever is the payment, it is done. If the risk, finally, we land up with a higher financial risk value than what was assessed, then there is a sharing. So he is responsible that he will not give me any Tom, Dick and Harry scheme, because he is sharing the risk with me. And the risk is on both time risk as well as the financial risk. So that is, this is something which we then flagged it up with Government of India. Our project is, again, I have not written here, but the government has given a mandate that it will be monitored by, not only by Railway Ministry, which is my administrative ministry, it is being monitored by Niti Aayog. So Vice Chairman Niti Aayog is the co-chairperson, and Special Advisor to Prime Minister Japan is another co-chairperson. So this committee, the joint committee, they are appointed by Government of Japan and Government of India. And then they review the project every 3 months. So we got this concept cleared from the joint committee, and now we are implementing this concept. For steel fabrication, we have offered this. Yes, there is an issue. So let the Japanese company come along with us. We don't want to give this work outside India. We have to learn. So we have requested Japanese company come and form joint venture, improve the quality of our fabricators so that future projects, at least we have the real quality with us. Next. This is something interesting, the Vadodara challenge I was talking about, the 240 meter. And see, normal what we have done in railways, all of us who have been dealing with railways, is a lot of launching methods, side slewing, lateral slewing, then through launching nose and all. But with a lot of deliberations, I found this is something new, at least I have not done, that we will be doing, we will be doing launching by rotation. So this is something first time we'll be trying, I'm not sure, but then we'll come up with a detailed scheme. The idea is to minimize the work above the existing track, because if you have to do linear launching or any other method which is conventionally applied, you have to occupy the existing tracks, which we can't do. Area of construction is very, very limited. If some of you have visited Vadodara, both side, platform number 6 and this side, platform number 1 and 7, both side, it is all buildings, multi-storied buildings. So there is hardly any area to really spread your construction activities, and also to minimize the construction period. So the steps would be, we will assemble it across the alignment where the space is available on platform 7, then rotate the main side span, then launch it, whatever length is available, short, that we'll do by linear launching, and then remove the erection girder and put the assembly girder at the end span. With the help of crane. I think from the diagram you will be clear. Next. So this is how it will be. In the figure, it doesn't look so big a truss, but this height is expected to be about 60 meter. The truss height is expected to be about 60 meter. This is entire Vadodara yard. Our final alignment will be like this. What you see is hedged area is platform number 7. On this, we will assemble the girder. This will be one pier, another pier, about 240 meter. Then
One is span 120 meter, another is span 100 meter approach span. So total steel portion will be 100 plus 240 plus 120. Now the entire assembly, and what you see in green is a erection girder. It will be finally removed and a regular girder will come. The idea is we can't have such a heavy weight for cantilever, so we had to put erection girder. This is what is red is the actual main girder. So we'll assemble it, and if you see here, this pier is the rotation center and this is the pushing point. So we'll put the pushing point with the help of jacks, caterpillar jacks. This entire assembly will be rotated, and this throw is around 40 meters. So the rotation will be about 40 meters, and then this leg will come somewhere here, and this launching nose will rest on the pier. Next. So if you see what I've explained, the rotation is complete. Now the main girder goes and this launching nose comes on the pier. And we have to then push, because this portion is providing a balancing action at the time of rotation. So we have to push. Initially, it will remain here and the launching nose is somewhere here and this end is on this place. Then we push, do the launching, and main girder comes here. This launching nose comes further beyond. Next. And then this launching nose is removed and we put the last portion of the girder with the help of the crane. So this is something, at least to my knowledge, we have not tried it even on Indian Railways so far. This is something we have no options except to do this. Next. So that was three, four challenges which I thought we share with you. LIDAR, as I said, is a successful thing, but this is something which is the 240 meter erection is something which is still in conceptual stage, and we have to see how it will work. Overall plan, we made, in fact, when we got the feasibility study, about 323 kilometer was on embankment. Then a lot of brainstorming was done for two, three reasons. One is looking at the socio-economic character and the demographic structure of India. A lot of trespassing takes place as of now, a lot of villages on the side, so cattle passing and a lot of human being crossing the track. Indian Railways as such is facing this problem, and you can't afford to have this kind of crossing on high speed at 320 kilometer if some cow or some fellow comes. So it will be a catastrophic thing. So this was one issue. Then the second issue, land acquisition as such is a problem on any project. So the idea was to reduce the land acquisition to whatever extent it is possible. So then we decided later on that we will remove this embankment portion and go on viaduct. So viaduct, in fact, if you see, had we had embankment, the width required was around 36 meter. It's almost reduced to half, 17.5 meter now we are. Our right of way will be around 17.5 meter, which includes 12.5 meter of actual girder width for the high speed track. It will accommodate two tracks and a 4 meter road, which will be the maintenance road along the alignment. Next. Coming to the rolling stock, a lot of interesting features in rolling stock. See, a long nose. So it's not a something aesthetic is done for aesthetics. It's a requirement of the design. Once you, at such a high speed, you enter into a tunnel. So a high pressure zone is created, and when it exits, so it's very strong micro pressure waves are generated because you are moving at 320 kmph. And Japanese were, for quite some time, were struggling with this issue. What they found that initially the Japan Shinkansen came in 64, and Japan is a country of lot of hills, so they have lot of tunnels. What they found that they started getting complaint that beyond their right of way, the buildings which were existing, the
private buildings which were existing, they found, they got the complaint of cracks in those buildings. So initially they were not able to understand why is this, then finally they figured out, yes, it is an effect of high speed. Now why is this? Then they discovered this phenomena, that because of the micropressure waves which are created, it becomes a big air bubble, hits the building, causes a lot of forces, and the cracks are done. Then this entire problem was referred, they have a very good institute, RTRI, which is being funded by all the operating railways of Japan. It's a very good concept. So they fund RTRI, and then each operating railway, if they face some problem, they refer it to RTRI. And RTRI, then they do further research and come up with the solution. And interestingly, they found a very simple solution for this problem. Now, ahead of the tunnel, they are putting a steel hood with small windows in that hood. So beyond each tunnel exit, you will see a steel structure about 25 meter long with a small windows. So it's such a simple solution. This big bubble of micro pressure, it was broken into small bubbles, because now it will exit through small windows, and then this problem was solved. So they are suggesting the same thing to us. We will also go for the same arrangement, but it took them about 5 years to find out this solution in Japan. So this is something which is unique to high speed.
Next.
Rolling stock design, the air drag is one of the important feature, because lot of wind pressure is there, and the power of the rolling stock has to counter that air drag. Now to achieve high speed of 320 or 350 kilometer per hour, you have to reduce the air drag. So if you imagine what I'm showing here on the photograph with what is, we have been traveling on the Indian Railway trains, you will see that even you can't see the wheels. Then if you look at this handle, which is a driver cab, and driver has to hold the handle and go inside. So to reduce the air drag, this will open only at a low speed. When the speed is less than 30 kilometer per hour, then this will open, and as it crosses 30 kilometer per hour, these handles will automatically close and flush with the body. So again, to reduce the air drag, because otherwise the air will get entrapped in the car body and this handle, and air drag will increase. The junction of the two coaches, so they have provided fairings, and again a smooth surface, so the air should not get trapped between the two coaches. A lot of work has been done to achieve this speed for the purpose of reducing the air drag.
Next.
Another is a pantograph. Pantograph is an equipment which collects the current from the overhead equipment and then feeds into the rolling stock, and all the motors are then operated with this pantograph. So it's a very specially designed pantograph, all multi-segmented contact strip. And this is again, because it is rubbing against the contact wire all along, so you have to reduce this rubbing force also. So that is why these contact strips. And this is one of the source of noise creation. So this has been done for two purposes. One is to reduce the force, these multi-segmented contact strip. And if you see, even a cover has been provided to reduce the noise which will be created due to the rubbing of pantograph with the contact wire.
Next.
Another interesting feature which you will have in high speed is, all of us would have traveled in aircraft and would have felt some time problem in the ears. Now at high speed also, particularly in tunnel, when the high speed train goes, so there will be a problem in ears if we don't take these measures. So the entire car body is pressurized, and the pressure is maintained above the atmospheric pressure, so that you don't have problem in ears. Interestingly, if those who are interested in further design in rolling stock, when they were designing these high speed and they were pressurizing, so the problem came that the toilet seat started misfunctioning. the entire excreta started coming out. So lot of issues, and then solutions were found by the Japanese that how to keep it pressurized, and the toilet problem is also not there.
Next.
This is again first time, probably will not probably, this is first time we will be bringing it in India because of the sound noise which is created. So this is a double skin shell. You have one plate here, and then with cross bracings it is connected all through. This is an aluminium shell to reduce the noise level inside the train. As of now, it is not being manufactured in India. The double skin aluminium shell is not being manufactured. We will have to talk to Nalco. Nalco is the company which is doing. So this is one area which is of interest to all of us, if it can be manufactured here in India. The size is about 3.35 meter, the width. And I'm not going into much detail. The bogie portion, because bogie creates maximum noise, so the under frame is quite different in bogie portions. We have provided double layer above the under frame so that the noise from the bogie is, doesn't go up inside the coach and the passengers are not disturbed.
Next.
I have explained, they will, to reduce the air drag, the bogie covers have been provided. Fairings, I think I have explained. Pantograph ties, yes, this also I have explained. Next. This is another interesting feature of high speed. When we travel in the train, and most of the time you would have seen when train negotiates the curve, you feel lurch, sometimes a big lurch. Now, to counter that, this device, vibration detection has been provided in all the coaches. So the sensor is there, and it will detect if some lurching is going to take place, then it will send signal to the controller, and then controller will actuate this device, vibration prevention, with electric actuator. Now this device is, if it is going to lurch on the left hand side, then it will open up on the right hand side and counter the lurch, so that the lurch doesn't, is not felt by the passengers. So it can operate both ways. Whatever, whichever direction the lurch is going to take place, it will open on the opposite side, and the lurch feeling will not be there to the passenger, and this will be absorbed by this device. These are few important features. Then these are air springs. Again, depending upon if you are on curve, one spring will deflate, another spring will inflate. So again, it will adjust.
Next.
Driver cab, so driver have will have the entire information available with him on board. This arrangement, Mumbai-Ahmedabad high speed, we will not have any line side signal. All of you would have seen iron mast with red, green and yellow signal. It will not have any such red, green or yellow signal. It's a moving block signaling, and this is on board signaling. He will have entire information on board. So speedometer, then these are two display units, including what is the health of the coaches in the running condition. If he wants, he can see on the screen. The choice is whatever he wants to see. So on one screen, he can see the complete length of the train, which motor is operating, which is malfunctioning, what is there. Then depending upon if he feels that coach number 9 is having some problem, he can zoom it and bring it on this screen and see what is the problem. And then interact with the operating control center on a real-time basis.
Next. Signaling system.
This is digital automatic train control. So this is the heart of the entire high-speed running. Idea is the signaling system, it has to be safe and ensure punctual running. Incidentally, Japan has punctuality record of less than 1 minute, around 40 seconds punctuality they operate the trains. And in last 52 years, there is no fatality on Shinkansen system. So this is the only unique system which has not registered any fatality in last 52 years. All other high-speed system, whether Europe or China, some accident has taken place and there has been fatality, but Japan is the only system where there is no fatality.
Major component for the signaling, coded digital audio frequency track circuit. We have heavy duty point machine, and there is a fallback system. If this coded digital audio frequency track circuit doesn't work, then we move on the GSMR system, and then radio communication takes over and driver will start getting the signal from radio signal. And all these equipments are remotely monitored in the OCC. Next. Just go back. This is digital ATC and fallback. This is radio system. This is a fallback arrangement. Next. A small explanation on how the digital ATC works. These are track circuits. 1, 2, 3. I've just numbered them. Each 1 kilometer length. Now suppose a train for whatever reason has stopped here. Now the previous train would get a signal because it has stopped here. If you look at this, the maximum speed will be 320. At 320, it will get a signal at track number 10. So it will start getting signal from track number 10. Now since it is 275, so now it is getting signal at track number 6. And now it will get the signal, ATC wayside equipment will start giving him signal that he has to stop at track number 2 because there is a train standing at track number 1. And driver has to do nothing. It is all automatic train control. So once he generates the signal, this ATC wayside equipment generates the signal that he has to stop at track number 2, then automatic braking will stop. So he is at the full speed. Now the automatic braking is taking place and he will stop here. Driver will do nothing. It is all automatic. Next. Brief explanation on how the ATC works, how the train is detected. Look at this system. These are two tracks. And the track circuit, we feed the power here and the relay is here. This distance is about 1 kilometer. Now, when there is no train, you see these arrows, the circuit is complete and the relay gets the signal and relay is energized. So, everybody notes, including the OCC, yes, the relay is energized and the signal is sent and this track is unoccupied. Now, once the train comes here, so this is the axle of the train, the two wheels which are connected. So, now it short circuits the complete circuit to relay. So, now the current starts flowing within this circuit. So, the relay will not get the current and relay gets de-energized. So this is how the signal is sent. From the energization to de-energization, the signal is sent to OCC, to the train, to the previous train, the train which is behind, that this track is occupied. Then this is the normal operation. The good feature of this system is all of us would have heard the tragic Utkal Express accident, and there are many more which have taken place because of the rail fracture. Utkal Express was not rail fracture, but he was trying to change the broken rail and then unfortunately did not protect, and then that accident took place. Roorkee, we had accident because of the rail fracture. There are many accidents because rail fracture is one of the issue currently on Indian Railways. Now, in this case, it detects the rail fracture automatically. Because if the rail is broken here, then again the circuit is not complete and relay is de-energized. So, even though there is no train, but the connection is broken here because of the rail fracture, so relay is de-energized. So, automatically braking will start and the train which is behind it will automatically come to a stop. So, it's a absolutely fail-safe arrangement which we are going to adopt here on high speed. Next. Again, some indication, we have equipments, from previous track circuit it will receive, then code are generated, goes, and then there is a pickup unit, pickup coil in the train, then it pickups the coded data, and then everything goes here. Now the system in European and Japanese, the variation is Europeans only send train control data. Japanese technology is still superior. Other than train control data, they transmit all the information. Passenger information, everything is transmitted through this.
Next.
This is again a difference between the technology which we are getting and a general available technology. Normal braking is, all of us would have experienced that you, once the train starts reducing the speed, you start feeling some jerks. Why you feel so many jerks is because the braking is in steps. So at every step when brake is applied, you feel jerk. They, in this Mumbai-Ahmedabad rolling stock, this entire thing has been smoothened, and it will be a very uniform braking. So you will not feel the jerk. Even when the brakes are applied, you will not feel the jerk.
Next.
Again, I think not very clear picture, but these are the turnouts when you change the track, unlike road where steering is there and you can change the course or the lane of your vehicle. In railways, you provide point machine, point and crossings. This is tongue rail, and then behind is the crossing. For high speed, the difference in crossing is that on Indian Railways, the crossing is a fixed crossing. So the wheel jumps over the crossing. But on high speed,
next,
it will be a moving block crossing. So if you look at this, this is the crossing. Now this portion of the crossing will move. Depending upon which direction you have to set the track, it will move. I think some animation has been prepared. Let me try. So right now, just hold on. Right now, the track is set for the loop line. Loop line is this line. So right now, the track is set for the loop line. Next. Now, if you have to change and set the track for the main line, next. So now, next. Go back. Yeah. So I think there's something wrong. This is loop line, and when you change the track, so this will it will come this side and create a gap here, and this will go that side. So the crossing moves.
Next.
This is I was telling you the fail-safe arrangement in case if there is any problem in the ATC, some equipment malfunctions, or there is any problem. So all along we will have LCX is leaky coaxial cable. It's a copper cable with the perforations in this cable, and then it continuously emits signal. So like you have your mobile thing working with the towers and the antennas. So this leaky coaxial cable is releasing information continuously. And this creates a kind of information channel 70 meter on either side. And in case this digital ATC, the automatic this audio frequency circuit is not working, then this train will start getting the signals automatically through radio frequency. So train operation will not be affected, and the safety will not be jeopardized.
Next.
Again, this is something new. We are going to use gas-filled cables. Now, cable failure is one of the big issue. So here, all the cables will be gas-filled. It will kept under continuous pressure of gas. Now, in case a cable is having some micro crack or something, the gas will release and the pressure will drop, and automatically in automatic operation control center, he would know that this track circuit, this cable has a problem.
Next. Coming to overhead, the different feature which we have on high speed, you see, you can't feed the power from one end right up to the next end. Generally, we have substation at every 50 kilometer. So a substation is feeding 25 kilometer this side, 25 kilometer this side, then another substation. So every 25 kilometer or so, you will have a junction where power is coming from this side and power is coming from this side. So you need to create a barrier between them. In railway terminology, we call it neutral section, because the phase of this side and phase of this side are different and they can't interfere. I'm not an electrical engineer, probably electrical engineers will understand. But these phases can't interfere with each other, so you have to create the neutral section. On Indian Railways, the driver lowers the pantograph so that he doesn't enter into two sections simultaneously. So he lowers the pantograph. At high speed of 320 kilometer, the human reaction will not permit him to do these operations of lowering and raising within that limited section of neutral section length. So here they have gone for the automatic thing. Next. You can show these. This is the neutral section. So blue is one feet from one substation, red from another substation. So what happens is, this is automatic switching neutral section they have provided. It's a small animation. It comes here. Next. This goes down. So that section is off. Now, next. This comes up in action and this circuit comes into action. So driver has to do nothing. The attempt in high speed is that you put minimum load on the driver so that he is not pressurized with so many functions to be done by him. Next. Because the speed is high, you need more current, so the section is bigger. We need to put, when we call tension, see, you have to keep the contact wire straight. You will realize that if the contact wire is not straight, if there are sags in the contact wire, it will entangle with the pantograph. And pantograph will break, train will stop. So you need to keep these wires under tension to keep it straight. So, because the speeds are high, the size of the contact wire is high, so you need higher tension to keep it straight. Another interesting thing is, anything, if you have a wire and you are pushing it and running it, so because of this push force, a wave will be created in the wire. In high speed design, or for that matter, any railway track design, you have to ensure that the wave created because of the push force runs ahead of the train. Otherwise, again, the pantograph will have to hit in the wavy section. High speed, it becomes difficult, because you are already running the train at 320 and you need to create the wave in the wire which is more than 320. So they are designing with the wave speed in the wire of about 400 kilometer per hour, 400 to 450 kilometer per hour. Now, to achieve that also, you need to put more tension in the wire. So that is the difference of high speed versus normal thing. Next. Oh, because of that reason, we have compound catenary. So one wire is hanging, then another wire is hanging, one dropper, another dropper, and this is the contact wire. Normally, in normal sections, this is not there. This green wire is not there, and it is directly hung from the catenary wire. Next. This is the last segment. Few special features for safety. So we have four kinds of natural disasters. Earthquake, rise in temperature, which is not under our control, wind, and the rain. This system is providing preventive safeguard for all these disasters. This is again something new which we are getting from Japan. So I'll go one by one. I hope I have exceeded my time, but I have another 10 minutes. Okay. So early earthquake detection system, it works. I'll come to the concept. Right now we are providing seismometers, 22 numbers along the alignment, so around at every 25 kilometer, And the seismic prone areas on this project is Bhuj, Latur, Koyna. So we will be providing seismometers at these locations also, Kutch, Koyna and Latur region. Now these seismometer which we are providing at Kutch, Koyna and Latur, they will detect the primary wave. If some earthquake is taking place, they will detect the primary wave, sends the signal to our these seismometers, 22 seismometers. Normally they are provided in the electrical substations, and the automatically it will switch off the power and the trains will come to a stop. So idea is, once the earthquake hits, the secondary wave hits the project area, there is no train operation which is going on at that time. Schematically, suppose this is the epicenter. We have provided the seismometer somewhere here. It will detect the primary wave, then send the signal. As soon as it detects the primary wave, it will send the signal to the seismometer which is provided near our track. And as soon as it detects the P wave, the emergency brake will apply and the trains will come to a stop. Next. So this is how we are going to do Kutch and Koyna region and Latur region. A small room of about 4 meter by 4 meter. These locations we have not finalized, we are still doing the survey. So these will be provided to detect the primary wave, and then function I have already explained how it will be done. Next. Rail temperature, because rail fracture is one of the issue, and since India, particularly this region, witnesses very high temperatures. So we'll be providing 5 sensors. It will sense from minus 5 to 70 degrees centigrade. The system is designed for this variation. Anything more than this, anything beyond this, then we will have to reduce the train speed. That is not automatic. The operation control center will take a call. Yes, the temperature has gone to 75 or 80, and now we should reduce the train speed to from 320 to 160 or so. Next. This is how it will be done. These are the temperature sensors. It will be provided under the web of the rail. So normally we will keep the system in neutral range of 30 to 35 degree, and this will record in case it is going beyond 60 or going beyond minus 5, then the action will be taken for controlling the trains. Next. Wind is another area. So we will provide anemometers, 14 numbers in our project. And if the wind speed goes beyond 30 meter per second, it will send an alarm to OCC and the train operation will be stopped. Next. This is how anemometer will be provided, and it's just a brief explanation. So if you see, these are the wind speed, this is the time. Now wind is crossing, if you see here, 30 here it is crossing, so it has stopped. Below 30, then there are speed restrictions in the yellow area, which means around 25, then we put a speed restriction of 160 kilometer per hour. Now, wind is something we have stopped, and then the regulation is, after the wind speed has come down within the limit, we will wait for 30 minutes and then start the operation. It is not immediately after this. Next. Rain monitoring gauges, though it's not a big issue because ours is all elevated, but still we have a small around 2.5% of the section on the embankment. So we will provide rain gauges, 6 numbers. It will record hourly as well as 24 hour. And this is the standard practice in Japan. So we will work out for India that what should be the threshold value for hourly along with the 24 hour value at which we should put a speed restrictions. This study is going on. We have not worked out the figure for this. Next. So we'll record these, and for our project, this 24 hour along with hourly figure, we have to decide the limit, at what limit we should restrict the train operation. Next. This is the last slide, which I thought, since you are all engineers, young engineers, So I thought that what are the areas which we can really do something. So some of the areas I'll just explain. Construction machine and the technology. What we have now, what we have experienced is not good enough to achieve the required progress. What Chinese have done is full girder launching, and they are able to achieve two girders with one machine every day. The kind of arrangement we have is this cantilever construction, segmental construction. In metros, I checked up with Delhi Metro, the average is one girder per week. So that is the difference, one girder per week to two girders per day. Technology internationally is available, but this is something I thought we must discuss within ourselves, that how this can be developed in India. To achieve this, our girder, a 40 meter span girder, will be weighing about 1,100 ton. So that is one task, that how to, which is, this is, if you compare it with the metro girders, it is around 1.5 times the weight. So this is one of the challenge. I just share the challenges which we have. We are yet to solve those challenges. Then simulation studies at 350 kilometer for viaduct structure, and to understand dynamic behavior. So this is something which we would like to really work as a, in the innovation center or whatever we may call, so that we know that what is the dynamic behavior at this speed, and then take design precautions accordingly. As of now, personally, I feel there are a scope for design optimization, but we can't attempt those optimizations unless we are sure about this. Then independent simulation studies for train running vis-a-vis girder vibration, because impact factor is decided with the girder vibration. What we are following is what is being done in Japan, which is mostly segmental construction. If we go for pre-tensioned or post-tensioned full span girder launching, maybe this arrangement or the response is different. So if we know that what is the kind of response, probably we can come to a realistic impact factor. Again, this is one area, if we are sure, probably we can try design optimization there. Development of special material like stacky jelly to avoid theft. This is one of the features typical to India, particularly copper cables, they are stolen. Now, Japanese have developed, told them this, that this leaky coaxial cable is this much thick cable, full of copper. I said it will be stolen. Then they came up with a solution, no, we will put up a jelly, and that jelly will become hard. It will permit your signals to come out of the jelly, but nobody can cut this jelly. So that is something, now it is, right now it is not available with us, but this is something I leave, if some chemical engineers are here, this is one area for you to do innovation and come up with this idea, that put some chemical which permits the operation of that cable without anybody having access to that cable. You can see it is a transparent jelly, but you can't cut that jelly with any saw or anything. Then OHE, I said, this, the current contact wire is a special alloy which will come from Japan, because we don't have any alloy and the factory which produces this kind of contact wire. Now, this is another area for our material science engineer to see, that what kind of tension is required and how the alloy can be developed. Now, these are, if India has to develop 10,000 kilometer of high-speed route, so these are the areas where all the technical fraternity, including young engineers, have to work and then see that how we can become the leader in this area. And last is troubleshooting simulator. We are getting a driving simulator from Japan. Now, this troubleshooting simulator is one, if something has gone wrong in the machines in the rolling stock, so they have a troubleshooting simulator in Japan which simulates that, okay, if you are facing this problem, what could be the trouble? Now, this is one area where we are struggling, because the cost being asked is very, very high. Now, I'm not saying for high speed. I'm throwing this as a common challenge, that any moving part car or bus or train or aeroplane, can we develop a troubleshooting simulator wherein you know that this is the problem, the driver has told me this problem, what could be the probable troubles? So if we can develop a simulator, it will really help the entire system, all the transportation system, which can really come up as a big boon for all of us. And of course, we all supply software and to the whole world. Now, every such thing is driven by softwares. I have not written that, but it's a big challenge for the software engineers. We can discuss it, what kind of softwares we have. I'll closely work with you, sir, and we will try to come up with many more such ideas, and if we can really come up with certain such systems with concrete solutions. That was the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for listening patiently.